So where we spend our money is also where our hearts are. So as we combine our hearts together this year and this day, as the beginning of this budget year, I ask that you would stand. And your response this morning is going to be, make our work holy, O God. Through our worship and praise and music, make our work holy, O God. In ministries of wholeness and healing, make our work holy, O God. As we share with one another, when we seek the right words and actions in time of grief and pain, make our work holy, O God. When we join voices and hearts together to seek justice for all people, make our work holy, O God. In every act of ministry done in Christ's name, make our work holy, O God. Amen. Stay standing for our next hymn. The blessings of being a church together is that we get to pray together and for each other and for the world, for people we've never met and for our closest relatives. So there are some folks that I would like to highlight for you today that are in a special need of our prayers. Nancy Phipps is in Claps Rehab for a few weeks as she regains some strength before she goes home. Is there anyone else that you would like to pray for? We continue to pray for Jacob and for Lori Arrington as Jacob continues to gain his strength from his time in the hospital and Lori for her job. Anyone else? Praise report for that. Lydia Moser is home. Still needs our prayers, but one step closer to healing. Trey, who has cancer, is still in need of our prayers, has had some healing, but not yet where he would like to be. Yes, what it means to be a people who seek your voice. We know that at the heart of that seeking is our prayer life. And so today, oh God, as we come to you in prayer, we humble our hearts before you, surrendering our wills to yours, asking that you would grant us peace and serenity as we steady ourselves in your presence. For Moses, as he approached the burning bush, took his shoes off, and he said, I must take my shoes off, for this is holy ground. And God, as we stand on this holy ground, as we have gathered together one people with many hands, one people with individual voices, we come together and lift up those who are seeking your comfort, your healing, your mercy, and your grace. We thank you for the healing that we have stood witness to this week. And we stand ready with open eyes and hearts to continue to watch you at work in those lives who still seek healing and wholeness. Be with us and others, O God, all over the globe, who are in need of your presence, who need to see you and feel you in real and tangible ways. And we ask on this day, that you would use us as agents of your change and of your kingdom here on earth. That we would speak words of your peace. That we would be about actions of justice. And that even our thoughts, O God, would be healing and would speak your name to others. Now hear us, O God, as we join our hearts, unified, praying the prayer our brother Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Thank you. prayer today continues in 1 Samuel, the 15th chapter, verse 34 through the 13th verse of chapter 16. Then Samuel went to Ramah, and Saul went up to his house in Gibeah of Saul. Samuel did not see Saul again until the day of his death, but Samuel grieved over Saul. And the Lord was sorry. Then made Saul king over Israel. We're going to come back to that part. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you.'" Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord has anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him." Do you know what's happening? He's gone and he's now before Jesse. He's at the table and having sacrifice. And he is gone because God has said the next king is to be among Jesse's descendants. And so now one by one, as they come to this feast, Samuel is saying, "Is this the one, Lord? Surely this is the one." But so far, God has said no. "Do not look on his height or on his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. The Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him, upon David. From that day forward, Samuel then sent out and went to Ramah. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
crucial to this story about King David. For reasons you may know, and for one that I'm getting ready to tell you. So I stand without my heels on at 5 feet, no more, no less. That's all you get. So I always had this impression of little David. Do you get that impression? I don't know that we have any idea how tall David was. We just know he wasn't as tall and striking as his other brothers. And we just know that David had been kind of put out to the pasture, so to speak, with the sheep. And although shepherding was noble work and would become even more noble seen in God's eyes, when he was called to the sacrifice to parade before Samuel his best, I think of him as little David coming maybe sheepishly before his brothers, wondering why it was that he was called in from the fields. So when I was working as a chaplain at Baptist Hospital, big place, little person, I often walked into rooms with many, 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 many white coats. I often would be in a room before the white coats would come in. The doctors and all of the staff that were working, the residents and the interns that were working and rounding tirelessly, I had such admiration for them. And many of them came to have admiration for me. It was a mutual time to be together, to do ministry and medicine in the same place. But before they knew me and before I knew them, they often mistook me for somebody else. I was the little sister. I was a cousin. I can't even tell you all of the things that they thought I was, but never once did anybody ever guess that the little person standing in the corner or kneeling down beside a family member at a bedside, no one ever thought, at least on first glance, making their rounds, that I was a chaplain. So I cut my hair, thinking that maybe that would make me look older. A really short haircut. And I even had some folks ask me if I needed to find my way back to my room at Brenner's Hospital. That sparked the haircut, by the way. And so when I became a pastor, I was in this group called the 2030 Clergy Group, where members in their 20 and 30 years of life got to join together. And one of the shirts that was created among the group said, it was bright green, so nobody could miss it. And it said, "This is what a clergy looks like." I enjoyed wearing that shirt. I had to give it up because I'm no longer in my 30s. But I think about what Daniel must have felt like on this day when he came in from the fields. I wonder if he thought he was in trouble or if he was going to be given assigned yet another menial task that nobody else in the family wanted to do. And I love most of all, I love that God said, "Do not look on each of these sons as the world looks on them. See with my eyes. Know with my heart who is being called to be the king of my people." Saul wasn't the one. Even though Saul had this great ability to protect, even though sometimes he didn't do a very good job, Saul had all of those characteristics to go in and get the job of king done. But that was not what God had in mind. David, the shepherd, was the one that God had in mind to keep the flock, to tend to the sheep, not just the four-legged sheep, but you and all of the ewes, to tend the sheep. So David comes in. Can you imagine what that was like for little David to walk in front of all of his brothers, and then for Samuel to say, "This is the one," and he takes that horn of oil that God had instructed him to take. And I can imagine that Samuel, you would have to have a great deal of confidence when you are setting out on a trip that just might get you killed. killed, but the soul might find out what you were up to. But he took this horn of oil, knowing that it would be utilized to anoint. My cup runneth over. It would anoint the next king. And on this day, when David walked in, Samuel said, "That is the one." And he took that horn of oil and he poured it on his head so that he would never forget that God was with him. Now this scripture has brought up some questions from time to time about what was God up to. It was just last week that God told Samuel to let Saul be the king. And where we know more than a week of time passed that Saul was king. Today, God tells Samuel to find a new king. And he said, "The Lord was sorry that he had made King Saul the king of Israel." I love this image of God being sorrowful. But we know what that feels like, don't we? We know what it is to make a decision, sometimes because we had no choice, and to be full of sorrow. On this day, in this time, it says that the Lord was sorry. The Lord was regretful. And so we wonder, why in the world would God have to be regretful? Well, think about in the history of the scriptures. We know about the Garden of Eden, don't we? That things didn't work out exactly like God had intended. That must have felt sorrowful to God. And then there was Noah and the ark and the great flood. And the scriptures tell us that the people had become so perverted that this is what had to happen. That God had no choice. And so in this scripture, we are now reminded yet again that God is not a fickle God. God does not change God's mind. But God works with the people. God needs us like we need God to do the right thing, to see with God's eyes, to hear with God's ears, to feel with God's heart, that we won't become the thing that God cannot change our minds around. God needs us to pay attention. And on this day, Saul was out, and Samuel was paying attention, and David has become the king. Lastly, I just want to highlight what it takes to be the one that carries the horn full of oil for the anointing. It takes courage, and it takes the ability to listen. I often wonder if I had been Samuel standing in front of that line of sons of Jesse's, with Jesse standing right there, I might have been going, "Oh, I hope I get this right. I hope I get this right. I hope I get this right. Oh, I don't think it's that one. Pretty sure it's not that one." And when the last one came, I think I would have gotten slightly nervous. What about you? Like maybe I had missed something? Samuel never wavered. He didn't go back through the lineup. He said, "Do you have any more sons? Because none of these are it." That takes courage. And that takes some listening. And so Jesse said, "Yeah, I have one more, but he's out in the field." And he said, "That's okay, because we're not going to sit down. We're not going to take a break. We're not going to stop doing what God has called us to do until he comes." And the rest is history. David became the king. A perfect king? Absolutely not. But the king that God needed for God's people? Absolutely. We're all here, not because we're perfect, but because in so doing, we gather around the table to remember the courage and the ability to listen that the disciples and Jesus modeled and taught us. And so we remember. And some of the most courageous times of their lives, how the disciples and Jesus gathered around the table the night before his death, and how they broke bread together and at that table where they were to eat, Jesus took that bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, broken, given for you. Take and eat." And on that same night, as the disciples, even the ones who would betray Jesus, gathered there with him and he washed their feet, he then also poured the cup for them and said, "This is the cup of new life, the cup of the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. When you eat and drink of this meal, remember me." Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, as we prepare for this meal that has been prepared so faithfully for us, we offer to you our sinfulness, and we humbly offer our lives to you. We ask that you would forgive us for all of the times that we push you away, for all of the times that we think we have to go it alone. And we ask that you would forgive us when we forget to listen. We ask that you would forgive us when we forget that we are a courageous people. For in you, all things are possible. And we know that your forgiveness abounds for us, O God, even as we prepare to take this bread and this juice. May it nourish us and strengthen us and give us new life so that we might be able to hear as you hear and see as you see. May this meal give us the strength to engage people and things and the world, to offer them love as you so freely give. In your holy and precious name, we ask this prayer. Amen. The way communion is going to work today is you are going to respond to this gift of love by moving yourselves towards the cross, getting up out of your seat and coming to the front, getting your kit of communion and returning to your seat. And we will take communion together once everyone has been served. So come forward, and Nick, will you help me? Things are now ready. that this meal still tastes the same. It tastes like love. It tastes like peace. It tastes like forgiveness. Thank you. That you can fill our bellies and our spirits all at the same time. Thank you. 61, the Guilford side of the lake. Any other highlights? Immediately following worship, we have Sunday school. So please make your way to the Sunday school classes, the disciples classes meeting downstairs in the fellowship hall, and the other adult Sunday school classes meeting just down the hall. If you are a student and you don't fit into either of those categories, you can meet me at the front of the church. As you go, let's stand up. Get some blood flow into our legs before we have to walk. Mary spoke a word in his song that said, change our worship into witness. Let us, without further ado, leave our seats from in here, these four walls that provide courage and strength, and go out into the world, that our worship will not stop here, but will become our witness as we walk and move in here.